Good evening, St. Lucia. Welcome to Healthwise, a production of the St. Lucia Medical and Dental Association in collaboration with HDS Radio 100. I am your presenter, Dr. Merle Clarke, thanking you as always for joining us and inviting you to stay with us for the next 90 minutes as we continue our discussion on COVID-19, St. Lucia's response, the global response. As we here in St. Lucia and the rest of the world continue to grapple with the unprecedented effects of COVID-19, one of the more disturbing trends which has been observed and reported on by the WHO and multiple countries is a steep rise in cases of violence, domestic violence, the abuse of children, and the like. It is in part a direct effect of the fact that people at home, cooped up, with nowhere to go in a sense, in keeping with the social distancing mandates necessary to fight COVID-19. St. Lucia is not exempt. And this evening, we will be speaking to the stakeholders who are, tasked with caring for patients, victims of domestic violence, and for our children. What can we as a citizenry do to protect our children and to protect our women? We've said it before and we will say it again. We can make it through this, but we have to do it together. We have to be each other's keepers. So what can we do to prevent or to curb domestic violence and the abuse of children during these difficult times? And often we hear the talk about alcohol. And yes, perhaps one can be empathetic to somebody who just wants a glass of wine to relax during these times. But the mere availability of alcohol very well may exacerbate some of these situations. Situations of excessive consumption of alcohol, if only for the fact that people are somewhat idle. And of course, the increase in violence, as you see generally, with alcohol use and abuse because of the fact that people are uninhibited. So combine that with the frustration and so many, the anxiety of so many other factors that COVID-19 has brought about, it really could have catastrophic consequences. So as a St. Lucia Medical and Dental Association, we fully support the ban on the sale of alcohol during this time. Now, St. Lucia, before we get to this evening's substantive discussion, which we will be doing as we did last week virtually, again in keeping a physical distancing, we will pay tribute to one of our fallen soldiers, Dr. Simpson. And I will let his family members, his closest friends, those who knew him best, let them speak to you, St. Lucia, of the great man that we've lost, the consummate professional, the larger than life individual. I will let them do it in their own words.
My father was a bon vivant. His presence made things taste and sound better. I kept a running list of restaurants that I had wanted to enjoy with him. He had a brilliant, fertile mind and was always a great sounding board and source of wisdom. Above all, he was a kind and loving father. Thank you, Dad. Your son, Henri Simpson.
Dr. Stephen Paul Simpson, my father, we will all miss you. I want to thank you for molding us into the amazing people we are. Not many can say they have experienced half of what you've showed us. You are the smartest person I know. Graduating high school at 14, getting your PhD in dentistry at 21, and always setting the bar high. An international man, the most interesting man with the best stories about his travels around the world, from the Arctic to Africa to driving all over Europe. Every island in the Caribbean, every spot in St. Lucia, you knew it all. The best days of my life were just doing the simple things with you, like driving down the coast listening to Kassav, playing cricket on Kazamba Beach, and especially hearing about your fantastic adventures. You were a race car driver, poet, chef, inspirational speaker, role model, father and friend. Everything reminds me of you. We will honor everything you instilled in us and will help keep your legacy strong within our children and through the generations to come. It is a joy in my heart that you met your grandchildren and made memories that will last forever. You said to me at a young age that a fortune teller told you to stay close to me because I would be rich one day. Well, I was rich because of you. Your kindness, sincerity, patience, charisma, and charm showed me the right way. Our house was home to all. My friends and loved ones are because of what you taught me, and I see you in everything I do. You were tough on us, but sacrificed so much to let us be the best we could. I hope I make you proud. I would not change anything about the days with you or have it any other way. We will all think of you as the ocean breeze you love so much. You are the shadow to my light, and our aim will not be out of sight. Watch over us until we meet again. I love you. I want to thank you, Dad. Thank you for everything. I would also like to say thank you to all my father's friends and family. I know you will miss him too. Rest in peace, Dad. Your son, Eve.
What is the measure of a man? Is it the money he has, the possessions he owns, or the power he holds? Is it the professional success he's achieved over the years? I don't think it's any of those things. The true measure of a man is how much he loves, how selflessly he shares, how consistently he lifts up others around him, with kind words, a listening ear, jokes, debates, or the very shoes on his feet. By this measure, my dad, Stephen Simpson, was immeasurable. I lost my dad, but only his body. His values and legacy lives on in us, his family. He loves our island, St. Lucia, the people and the land. He knew the island from coast to coast. I have vivid memories of waterfalls, beaches, liming and exploring the culture and food. He also took pride in being fluent in Patois, as it allowed him to connect with the people. I am grateful and comforted knowing how my dad positively affected the lives of many. Most of all, I will remember my dad for being a loving father, grandfather, husband, brother, uncle, and friend. I love you, Dad, now and forever. Your daughter, Tamara.
Alone cannot express the sorrow of the tragic loss of our dear Stephen, a loving brother, a good friend. We will miss you very much, Steve, your loving sisters, Sharman and Candy.
I am truly grateful for the opportunity to express the thoughts and memoirs of the dental community of our colleague, mentor and friend, Dr. Stephen Paul Simpson. Dr. Simpson was one of St. Lucia's most senior dental practitioners who was very knowledgeable, current and passionate in his practice. He had a very down-to-earth, humble and helpful personality. Dr. Jonathan Lesboris calls him a great mentor. He reflects and says, I first met Dr. Simpson as a young dental graduate 33 years ago, where we both worked in the government service. He was fluent in Creole and had a knack for effectively communicating with patients, particularly the elderly. He was a teacher, one who was always willing to share his skills, knowledge, and experience. His extraction technique was second to none, something I am thankful he was able to share with me. Simpson was not just my colleague. He was my mentor, my friend, and my personal dentist. I will always remember Dr. Simpson for his teaching skills and the joy he brought everywhere with him. He will always remain in my memory as a good man with his wonderful outlook on life. Most of us laud him for his willingness to always lend a hand, give advice, or assist with any challenging cases. As intimated by Dr. Naomi Michelle of Everyday Smiles Dental Clinic, as she writes, Dr. Simpson was an extraordinary dentist. It was always a pleasure having a conversation with him, as he understood the science of dentistry and was always willing to give an explanation of the do's and don'ts of the profession. He was a great teacher and a skilled professional. We at Everyday Smiles Dental Clinic will surely miss him. May his soul rest in peace. Not only did he provide guidance to the younger generation of dentists, but Dr. Simpson also made himself available to his peers. And so for Dr. Thaddy Aboud, who was moved by his sudden passing, expresses his disbelief by saying, "It was a very sad and shocking news. We met at dental meetings, called each other on dental issues. He was a nice person. That's all." Another of his peers, Dr. Francis Samuel, also agonizes and says, "I wish to express my sincere sympathy to the family and friends of Dr. Steve Simpson on his sudden passing. Dr. Simpson will always be remembered for his passion and competence in the profession." Dr. Simpson was truly known for his competence, his willingness to share knowledge, and affable personality. Doctors Diane and David Worrell share how they will miss his clinical expertise, kindness, and eagerness to share his knowledge. They remember him as someone always available to assist whenever called upon. They state, "He was always willing and genuinely happy to greet us wherever and whenever we met. Our entire office staff expresses condolences to his family and friends, which we considered ourselves. Farewell, good friend. Rest in peace." A loyal individual he was, Dr. Simpson, particularly to his patients, his staff, and to the science of dentistry. Not only did he impact on our lives and profession, he also touched the lives of his staff and patients. Mrs. Cheryl Sensi recounts in this tribute, "Dr. Simpson introduced me to the amazing dynamic world of dentistry in 1986, and I never looked back. I found him to be an affable, unselfish individual who was ever willing to share his knowledge of dentistry with his dental assistants. I was often moved by his compassion towards the elderly patients who more often than not were unable to pay for his services. He had a soothing bedside manner that the overly apprehensive patients took full advantage of. He had an affinity towards the children with intellectual disabilities and developmental disorders, as they were always miraculously cooperative with Uncle Steve. A profound memory I would like to share was when I applied for the post of dental assistant at the Ministry of Health. My application was addressed to Dr. Stephen P. Simpson, who was the then chief dental surgeon at the Ministry of Health, though I was still in his employ in his private office. He had no objections in recommending me for the position. We remained good friends until his passing. He will be missed by all of us." Dr. Simpson truly epitomized the qualities of an amazing individual and dental surgeon. Ms. Jermaine Guyon, another dental assistant, remembers him simply in her youth saying, "He treated me like his own child and showed a lot of respect. It is indeed sad to lose him," as intimated by Dr. Ewart Burt and Dipti Surapaneni. Dr. Jacqueline Charles says, "A great loss to the dental community," as she extends sympathy and condolences to the family, staff, and friends of Dr. Steven Simpson. She remembers him by saying, "The little time working alongside Dr. Simpson during my internship was memorable. His use of everyday life activities to explain dentistry was remarkable. Rest in peace, Dr. Simpson." Dr. Joanna Pamphil sums it all up in this piece, saying, "Dr. Paul Simpson, a name in St. Lucia, synonymous with dentistry par excellence, will forever remain an emblem of professional quality dentistry. Working alongside him was pure delight and at times intimidating, as he constantly challenged one's memory in the areas of anatomy and physiology. One was occasionally amazed by his innate ability to recall so much knowledge, skill, and experience when explaining complicated concepts in the most simplified ways. He was never too busy to teach something new. His patients marveled at his skill and the quality of his work. He was not daunted by new age technology and modern dentistry, and often commented that the fundamentals of the science of dentistry never changed. He was overly generous to those who could not afford dental services and emphasized many a time with the less fortunate. His kind-heartedness was evident in how he cared for his staff and took interest in their well-being, always concerned with the affairs of their families, present in moments of mourning, likewise in their celebrations. To those who love him, what a loss. His legacy lives on. And so with the many other expressions and sadness and loss from his colleagues and friends, the dental community mourns the death of Dr. Stephen P. Simpson, Uncle Steve, or Steve, and extends its condolences to his beloved family, friends, and patients. May his soul rest in peace.
I lost someone very special. He was my best friend, my teacher, my chef, my general practitioner, and so much more. Dr. Stephen Paul Simpson, the human embodiment of my heart, was grace personified. He had a big heart. He was kind, charitable, humble, compassionate, tolerant, and patient. His love and kindness knew no bounds. As a result, he was an exceptional father and grandfather who thoroughly took pride in these very important roles. He was also thoroughly loved by his children and grandchildren. Stephen was a man completely at peace with himself, a state of being that gave rise to one of his most enduring qualities. His inherent ability to see the beauty in everyone and harbor no malice against anyone. He had the rare quality of making everyone feel comfortable, secure, and loved. A quality, when paired with his jovial nature, allowed others to naturally gravitate to him. As we grapple with his physical absence, I say physical absence because he now resides in my heart, and that of everyone who loved him, and our inability to see the continued expression of these wonderful qualities, so many of us are left in a trail of tears. Stephen was well-traveled, attained the highest level of education in his field, and excelled in his profession, and served as a mentor to future generations of professionals. He took his oath to do no harm very seriously and never broke that oath. Even when a patient faced financial constraints. Despite his many accomplishments and the fact that he was larger than life, no one ever held too low of a station in society or was too young or old to be a beneficiary of Stephen's goodness. As a result, he touched many lives, both in and outside of St. Lucia, across generations, in a quiet way. Stephen lived and dedicated his life to St. Lucia. No other island or country pulled at his heartstrings like St. Lucia did. As such, he was fully immersed in St. Lucia culture and unwittingly influenced others around him to appreciate everything St. Lucia, from the local produce and fish to the local festivities. He made many contributions to and sacrifices for his beloved St. Lucia, and as I reflect on his legacy, I cannot help but beam with pride for having known his star and all that he represented. Stephen was the one who helped me remain steadfast through thick and thin, and helped successfully navigate through many life challenges. He was so full of life, and never wavered in encouraging me to be in love with and enjoy life. It absolutely breaks my heart to think that memories are all I now have of you. My best friend, Stephen, you were such a beautiful soul. As I reflect on the years I shared with you, my heart is overflowing with gratitude for the blessing and rare treasure that you were to me. Neither of us knew when we woke up that fateful Wednesday morning that God was going to call your name. The sadness of your departure has rattled me to the core, but God knows best. They say memories are golden. While this is true, I never wanted memories. Although my eternal wish of having you back can never be granted, your legacy, memories of you, memories of the life we shared, will always bring a smile to my face. Rest easy, Stephen. I will miss you. The Ferrier family will miss you. We love you. To and through infinity. Yours forever, Janice.
I have known Steve Simpson for almost 42 years. I met him in England several years ago, and then I met him back in St. Lucia in 1982 when he first came here. And we were friends before in the UK, and then we were colleagues here in St. Lucia. And it is with great sadness and sympathy that I have to say this today for him. I knew his entire family, his wife, his father, everybody, and I was very, very sad to hear of his early departure from our lives. Steve was an excellent oral surgeon. He was our mainstay when we didn't have other maxillofacial surgeons at the time. He was the one that went to the hospital any time, night or day, to go and fix up people's, wire people's mouths. We always called on him, because we needed to call on him, because we didn't have anybody else to call on. And he would wire people's mouths, and he would say, you know, I did two of these today or three of these. I had to go at 4 o'clock in the morning. So, you know, he did this enormous service to St. Lucia, which we cannot take away from him. He saved many lives with some oral surgery procedures that he did. And it was just something that we were just not able to live without somebody like him. We've been friends, we've been competitors, we are colleagues, but we are more friends than anything else. We were more friends. I saw him every day passing, mostly every day passing on the Chaussee Road with his car and say, "Hi, Asmina, you're too pretty to be a dentist. You should be an air hostess," because I'd like to see someone like that. That was when I was in my 20s and 30s. He never liked the idea that I was a dentist. He says, you know, you're too pretty to persuade people to do things you might not want them to do, and then you'll get away with it. He will be badly missed by our dental fraternity. He did more than just ordinary dentistry in our lives. I would run things by him once in a while. "Steve, what do you think?" He'd say, "Maybe a bit far-fetched, Asmina, you know. But he always gave me a positive answer for things. He always praised me. He always said good things about me. I will remember him for the rest of my living life. And I am so sad. And my deep condolences to his friends and family, and to all of us that are going to miss him terribly in our lives. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Dr. Ken Glass, oral and dental surgeon practicing in St. Lucia since 1975. Dr. Simpson was an excellent dental surgeon, especially in the field of oral surgery and oral pathology. He was responsible for the facial reconstruction of the many road traffic accident patients over the years. As a general dentist, he was adept at explaining the various procedures of dentistry to patients in Creole, which is not an easy task. He will be missed by the dental fraternity, and especially by me, for his constant advice on how to remain stress-free in dentistry.
Everything.
After that, St. Lucia, was Dr. Simpson. Once we have the details of the memorial service, of course, members, we will be letting you know so we can celebrate in a different way, obviously, the life and legacy of Dr. Steve Simpson. So we'll take a quick break now, and when we come back, we will start our discussion, very important discussion, on domestic violence and abuse during this time of COVID and what can be done to prevent or curb it. Back after the break.
The Gender Relations Unit has been liaising closely with the Gender Focal Point of the Ministry of Health and Wellness and the chairperson of the Stress Committee activated by NEMO to ensure that St. Lucia adopts a gender-sensitive response to COVID-19. Global Affairs Canada, one of the funders of the recently launched Engender project, has informed of its willingness to reprogram $100,000 to support St. Lucia's COVID response efforts. The use of these funds has been prioritized by the National Steering Committee as follows. 1. Provision of income support to two groups of women. Women who are the head of their households and have lost their jobs in the informal sector, and women farmers and agro-processors whose livelihoods have been adversely impacted. That first sector will account for 80% of the funding received. The balance of 20% will be allocated to the provision of personal protective equipment, PPE, for frontline workers. This group of persons will also benefit from training in psychological first aid and skills. International agencies such as UN Women and UNFPA have reached out directly to the regional gender bureau heads to pledge their support and share resources for governments to improve their response to COVID-19 in the context of gender equality and response to gender-based violence. Regional meetings with the ministers and directors of gender are being convened regularly to share best experiences, offer guidance, and identify opportunities and resources for the country-based responses to COVID-19. Both agencies have pledged support to St. Lucia by contributing to an improved communications focus on gender-based violence. This with the intention to increase public sensitization at a time when research has shown that situations such as what we are experiencing now with the corona pandemic can result in an increase in incidents of domestic violence. The UN Women, which continues to work very closely with us here in St. Lucia, has pledged to provide increased psychosocial expertise for victims of intimate partner violence. The work of the Women's Support Center continues. 202, which is the 24-hour hotline, is operational. One significant improvement to the service will be the provision of direct counseling services using a virtual platform. The response protocols for crises involving intimate partner violence have been changed slightly. The Royal St. Lucia Police Force is activated directly in response to crisis situations. The Gender Relations Unit and the Royal St. Lucia Police Force are monitoring the crisis calls for gender-based violence for any change in frequency and are ready to make adjustments to the protocols for response as needed in this crisis. The Department of Education, Innovation and Gender Relations and our partners are working expeditiously to ensure that there is access to information on gender-based violence in mainstream and social media. Please do peruse our social media platforms, and should you feel at all that your life is in danger, call 202, our 24-hour hotline. Thank you for listening.
The current global pandemic with COVID-19 has really brought to the forefront many challenges that are both unique to the pandemic and highlighted some areas and magnified them essentially. And one of those is the area of child abuse and neglect. COVID-19 has presented a unique set of challenges with regards to this and for children who are vulnerable. Parents in the household are stressed. There are many forms of stress that they are going through right now, be it financial, emotional, some physical stress. And their children are also stressed because their routines have changed, they're isolated, they're not seeing their friends, they don't have the school support, they may not have the school meal. There's many reasons that they are feeling stressed, and then that in turn shows different behaviors, regression, acting out. They could be depressed, they could be anxious, or they could be just normal. So it's a setup for having a bubbling pot in households where there may not have been abuse or neglect before. So there's an even wider net of children that need to be supported and cared for. The abuse, it's a fact that it is happening. There are reports globally that child abuse is increased. The abuse comes in many forms. It can be physical abuse, emotional abuse. It could be neglect, it could be sexual abuse, and then the most recent one and probably relevant here as well is virtual abuse or online abuse, because kids are at home spending a lot of time online, and this can be an area where they're quite vulnerable, especially if they're not being supervised appropriately. So all of that laying the foundation of how this setup of abuse, why it is increasing in places where it potentially would not have been before, to now how can we help as a solution. So we always say it takes a village to raise a child. We now kind of need a virtual village to help support these kids, because we can't be together as much, but there's different layers of protection and support that can be done for kids. The first thing is for parents themselves to recognize their own stresses and risks. They can recognize when they're feeling super stressed, they need to come up with strategies for decompression where possible. And you can find this in many different forums, online, listening, meditation, exercise, a variety of things, so that your stress levels are managed as best as you can within this pandemic. And then also recognizing the risks to your child, the persons that are in the household, confined to the household, with the online risks, etc. So you as a parent have a role to play. Don't leave your children unattended is another important fact, so that children are not being left at home alone for you to go to get provisions or go to work if necessary. You have to figure out what's a safe village to leave your children with. And the second layer, so that's for parents within the household, so recognizing your own vulnerabilities in this. Next layer is for neighbors. Neighbors hear things and see things. Look out for the children in your neighborhood, your immediate neighbors. If you hear any signs of abuse or think there's neglect going on, report it. See if you can help support in any way. Sometimes a chat over the fence or a chat on the phone, checking in on your neighbor, can help with some emotional stress and decompression. So be a good neighbor. And then the next layer is our teachers and our community workers. So you know who your vulnerable students and your vulnerable clients and your vulnerable kids are. And they are going to be the ones at highest risk, particularly children with developmental disabilities as well, or cognitive disabilities are also at increased risk generally, and even more so during this time. So check on your vulnerable students and clients and patients virtually where possible. Also provide them with opportunities for sharing. I know we're moving on to an online platform of learning, but providing them with opportunities to share with you a bit of what's going on. And then the other thing you can do is provide your students with numbers where they can call or report. So our human services numbers, where they can report if they have concerns and feel like they have nowhere to turn, that they also should be empowered, that there's somewhere that they can call or someone they can turn to. And then us as a nation and a wider community in terms of citizens, we're all going through this together and all being stressed, but reach out to your neighbors, your friends, your community. Help possible where you can with organizations that deal with the vulnerable, the needy, the poor, and try to help support parents in ways that can lead to their stress being decreased where possible. It's not going to be a short road, and we have to find a way to coexist, but also to support children's development during this time.
A pleasant evening to you, Dr. Clarke. Sincere gratitude expressed to you and teams for the tremendous work executed amidst this global pandemic. This is indeed trying times for us all. Well, domestic violence figures have increased significantly in recent years, but we have not had any cases specific to COVID-19 at the St. Lucia Crisis Center thus far. However, we have had cases where problems are magnified due to unemployment, which leads to depression, stress, and anxiety. With the current trend, though, we can anticipate an influx as families are forced to spend more time together, pre-existing problems emerge. This is an opportunity to cohabitate, yes, but people become fearful of the unknown future. These two can probably dictate how they treat their families. Well, we hope not. We continue to remind persons that it is so vital that victims seek help to stop the abuse, regardless the cause of the abuse, because it may just be a precursor to things to come. The Crisis Center provides some consolation. Counseling services are available. Please contact us at these emergency numbers: 486-1391, 485-8712, or 723-3448. Now, permit me to make a plea to parents and guardians regarding supervision of the children. For those who are at risk whilst they work from home, please, parents and guardian, be more vigilant. There are various forms of abuse that seem so prevalent. Our children need to be well cared for and protected. Children, you experience something, say something. St. Lucia, stay safe and please adhere to all protocols.
Thank you immensely for the opportunity to share as we reflect on greater cooperation whilst keeping Christ at the helm. Always remember, prevention is better than cure.
Janie Joseph, Acting Director, Gender Relations. We are required by national emergency orders to stay at home to avoid catching or passing on the COVID-19 virus. People, particularly women and girls, living with perpetrators of violence are at risk of facing increased levels of gender-based violence and increased challenges in implementing a safety plan or accessing services. Remaining home does not mean you are cut off from security and support. If you are harmed or feel unsafe, threatened, or harassed, you don't have to stay silent. You still have the right to a life free of violence and to get help. You do not have to manage this on your own. You can seek remote confidential support from the specialized 24-hour hotlines. Call 203 if you need general support to cope with challenging situations. Call 202 if you feel unsafe, threatened, or harassed by an intimate partner. Call 999 if you are in imminent danger. If you know your neighbor, friend, or family member is a victim of violence and is in imminent danger, do not hesitate to contact the specialized confidential hotlines 202 and 203 that continue offering services even during the COVID-19 pandemic. You can save someone's life. If someone you know told you she's experiencing violence at home and feels threatened from being confined at home with the perpetrator and gave you her consent, please call 202 immediately. If you feel that you or your children are at risk of sexual abuse or exploitation, reach out for help by calling the 202 or 203 hotlines or the Division of Human Services that continues offering services even during the COVID-19 pandemic. Violence is never an option. No one is excused for violence. COVID-19 is not an excuse for violence for anyone. COVID-19 is putting us all in a challenging situation. Exercise patience and tolerance. Exercise control over your emotions, particularly with your loved ones. A real man never abuses women, girls, and children in any circumstances, including during challenging periods like the COVID-19 pandemic. Staying at home presents new opportunities to improve family relations, to talk more, and to support one another more. Use the time to develop new hobbies, bond with family, and share household responsibilities to avoid leaving all the burden of care on women and girls. Share the care. Embrace and create peaceful relationships within the family. Conflict is normal whenever people interact with each other. Being asked to stay at home could cause tensions in your household. If you feel like you are too angry or frustrated and believe an argument may turn into a fight, take a break. Come back to the issue later when everyone feels more at ease. Women and girls, especially those who are pregnant or have specific medical needs, have a special right to be protected and cared for during states of emergencies such as this. Treat every woman and girl with respect. Take care of yourself. It will benefit your family and is a sign of strength. It is normal to feel helpless and worry about how this crisis will affect you and your family. It is okay to feel overwhelmed and tense. You are not alone. You can seek help. If you feel in need, reach out for support by calling the hotlines 203 and 202. Even if you feel that it is your role to protect your family, if members of your family have COVID-19 symptoms, support them by reaching out to the doctors at the respiratory clinics or the hospital. We can face this crisis together. Togetherness starts in the family. Families, more than ever, must be safe for everyone. Let us all do our parts to keep our families and our communities safe.
Violence against women is highly prevalent, with intimate partner violence being the most common form of violence. What we see globally is that one in three women worldwide have experienced physical or sexual violence by an intimate partner, or sexual violence by any perpetrator in their lifetime. So, but violence against women tends to increase during every type of emergency. And actually, though the data is scarce, reports from China, the UK and the US and some other countries suggest an increase in domestic violence cases since the COVID-19 outbreak. And there's one report from a city in the Hubei province in China, which stated that domestic violence cases actually tripled in February 2020 compared to the same period the previous year. Violence against women can result in injuries and serious physical, mental, sexual and reproductive health problems, including STIs, and as well unplanned pregnancy. And as if you look at violence against children, the effects of those can be lifelong, with psychological issues, children maybe turning to crime, turning to be sexual workers and so on, which can affect not just those children, but the entire society. As COVID-19 causes distancing measures to be put in place and people are encouraged to stay at home, the risk of intimate partner violence is likely to increase. And let's look at some examples. The likelihood that women in an abusive relationship and their children will be exposed to violence is dramatically increased as family members spend more time in close contact and families cope with the additional stress and potential economic job losses. Women may have less contact with family and friends who may provide support and protection from violence. Women bear the brunt of increased care work during this pandemic. As well, school closures further exacerbate this burden and place more stress on them. As resources become more scarce, women actually may be at the greater risk for experiencing economic abuse. And we may find that perpetrators of abuse may use this time to exercise more control and power over their partners to further reduce their access to help and psychosocial support during this time. Another thing which may happen is that access to vital sexual and reproductive health services may likely become limited, as we see that services have been scaled back, that a lot of the hotlines and so on may eventually stop working because of the financial burden to the society as a whole. So there is awareness of the impact of violence against women and children during this time. And there is a need to put things in place which can help mitigate the impacts of that, in spite of the immense burden which our health system is placed under at this point. So some of the things that can be done is, first of all, governments and policymakers must include essential services to address violence against women and children in the preparedness response and response plans for COVID-19. They as well need to identify ways to make them accessible in the context of the social distancing measures that have been put in place. Health facilities as well should identify information about services available locally. So what are the hotlines, where persons who are raped can go to, whether the crisis center is in operation, what counseling services are available for persons who do experience violence against women. In addition, they need to know the opening hours of these places, the contact details of persons who are involved, and they need to establish referral linkages with those organizations. As health providers, what we can do is become aware of the risks and health consequences of violence against women. And we can, as health providers, can help women who disclose by offering first-line support and relevant medical treatment. First-line support is what we call psychological first aid. And that can be done easily in any emergency room, in any doctor's office, by listening with empathy and without judgment, by inquiring about the needs and concerns of the woman, by validating the woman's experiences and feelings, enhancing safety in the environment of the health provider's office or cubicle if it's a hospital, and connecting those persons with the support that they need. In the community, what can be done is that committee members should be made aware of the increased risk of violence against women during this pandemic and the need to keep in touch and support women subjected to violence, as well as having information about where those persons can get help. It is important to ensure that it is safe to connect with women when the abuser is present in the home, because sometimes women don't disclose because they feel that the person may come back to get them. Women who are experiencing violence as well may find it helpful to reach out to supportive family and friends, seek support from one of the hotlines available. And I know that the helpline should still be operating and the number is 203. I also know that the crisis center, I'm not sure if what the hours are, but they should still be operating. I do not know the scope of the 300 helpline. And I know that the government as well had put out a number of psychosocial support telephone numbers, which I do not see being advertised too much. So maybe those can be advertised a little more so that women can be aware of the places that they can turn to when they are experiencing intimate partner violence, or even children who are experiencing an escalation of abuse in the household can turn to those helplines in order to get assistance.
During this pandemic, it has been quite challenging, and it has tested how we could get innovative so that we could continue to support the people that we work with. So the first thing we did was to secure donations, and we did some food packages. We distributed about 1,142 food packages and hygiene packs to our women and girls that we work with and families. We had to set up remote counseling, so we had to secure electronic devices so that we could set up remote counseling so that people not feeling as if in all of this they're alone. Then we realized the curfew and the state of emergency was going to be an extended period, so we had to apply for a pass from NEMO so that we were able to assist. We got an overload of calls from domestic violence victims, from gender-based violence victims, and what have you. We had to ask ourselves the question, was there anything put in place? And we did ask on our social media channels if anybody was aware that the family court and other associated agencies had put anything in place. One person said that the family court said they had left their numbers at the police station. And if somebody called the police, Ving, when I was asking this question, I was actually sitting at the Babono police station. And I wasn't away, and they were not away. But as of yesterday, the 21st, I saw there was a press release from the Department of Justice giving you contact information for the family court. But there was one day that we received at 27 calls, domestic violence calls. At one time, we had to be during the 7-day curfew. We had to be negotiating with domestic violence perpetrators. And listen carefully, we're not talking about domestic violence victims. We are talking about negotiating on the phone with domestic violence perpetrators, because the situation was such that no one could leave the house. We could not even go. We ourselves could not go to them. We have had to cancel physical home visits. We have had to be calling people on our phone day and night, and this is costing us because we have to pay for our minutes. We don't get anybody giving us anything. We have had to cancel the completion of our office space because of the state of emergency, and then nobody's giving a clear message when the country you can continue doing important things or not. We are getting bits and pieces. We are saying that when this state of emergency and this curfew was conceived, domestic violence victims and marginalized population, women and children, women living alone, women who are not employed, women who depend on people to give them handouts so they could cook, children who are being physically and sexually and emotionally abused at home or elsewhere, these were not factored into the plans. We at one time felt that people didn't have any other number to call. And then I saw the Minister of Gender Relations did a a press briefing or whatever that was, and she is speaking about getting $100,000 from Global Affairs Canada to give women household, women headed households, and women who have lost their jobs in the tourism industry only is in about 11,000. I don't know if she has tabulated this number. We are not talking about women hairdressers, nail technicians, housekeepers, people who sell stuff, people who do odd jobs, or people who just go out and beg to survive. $100,000. The minister is speaking about $100,000. This is peanuts. No proper planning was put in place. Long after the fact, we saw the director of human services on TV trying to speak. Nobody is watching TV. Everybody have their own pressures and trouble. And we feel that women and children, especially the poor ones, are always being marginalized, further marginalized by the government itself. We are not the government. We are not doing the government's work. We offered ourselves to support, and we do it as best as we can. But we are not in any way, shape, or form being subsidized for the government. The government has to do its job. And right now, we cannot even call for resources for the family court, for the Department of Human Services, for the Boys Training Center. We cannot call for resources because we know now what the problem is. There is no resources to call for. We have done the best we can. We have had to get very creative in how we communicate with people, how we deal with gender-based violence in this. Our greatest support always comes from the Royal St. Lucia Police Force. And we have to say thank God for the relationship we established with Mr. Moshiri and coming down to Mr. Daisy, that when we call them, they always support us.
On that very sobering note, St. Lucia, we will end Healthwise this evening. We hope again, we all remember that we are in this together. We can make it through. We will come out stronger, but we have to do it together. Let's each one help the other. Let's be each other's keepers. St. Lucia, now is not the time for quarreling and arguments. Now is the time to help each other through this very difficult situation. Protect our children, protect our women. And often there's the men. They've forgotten there are men who suffer abuse as well. It is important that we help each other, help the vulnerable in our communities. Remember, St. Lucia, this is not over. Our patients are doing well. Most have recovered and have gone home, as the chief medical officer said today. But the fight continues. We have to remember, stay home if you don't have to do something urgent. That is, see your doctor or get supplies for food and that sort of thing. Wear a mask if you're going out, and the mask is not to have under your chin or on your forehead or to be touching a lot. Wear the mask properly, otherwise you're defeating the entire purpose of a mask. Stay 6 feet away from other people in as much as you can. Treat everybody as if they have COVID, and that way we'll be able to curb the spread of this potentially deadly virus. Wash your hands. Remember, keep your hands washed or sanitized, because putting on a mask with dirty hands, you are defeating the entire purpose of the mask. Said Lucia, just pour dire pas toi, pour nous toutes savent, ces patients là nous n'y a yo qu'à faire bien, c'est ça qui est positif là, la caillou. Mais nous n'y pour comprendre cette Lucia, nous on ça ensemble nous toutes, et que nous n'y pour continuer et rester la caillou, nous laver les mains nous sous qu'à tousser, pas aller dehors, couper dans ces cliniques là. C'est number tout partout ça way. Si ou quoi ou ka senti overwhelmed, ou pas ça point encore ou ça couille un number, là ni moun pour aider ou. Nous ni pour faire ça ensemble cette ici pour nous sortir situation ça et plus bien pénoté avant. Nous ça fait, nous piti, mais nous ça fait qu'on paye. Plus vite nous fait ça nous ni pour faire, plus vite nous ka vie normal. Merci cette ici et nous ka invité pour joindre nous pour un autre épisode Healthwise semaine prochaine. Bye-bye.